baby is crying and stretching the pinna of the ear. This is a rather common sign that there is something wrong with the ear. Younger babies, sometimes they cry a lot, they stop feeding and they can't sleep at night. You take them to the doctor and after full examination you find nothing wrong with this baby, then you have to suspect a middle ear problem. Pus coming out from the external auditory meatus is very probably that there is an infection of the middle ear, rupture of the tympanic membrane, and pus coming out. This is serious condition. Blood coming out from the external auditory meatus, and this is a very bad sign. Although the blood may come out from injury to the external ear or the pinna of the ear, but one has to investigate that the cause is not coming from the middle ear, because this is a dangerous sign indicating probably fractured base of the skull. Pain of the ear is usually severe. It affects normal life and night sleep. These are few problems of the middle ear, and they can be enough to study the anatomy of the middle ear. This is a view of the beginning of the Staken tubes in the nasopharynx, and is usually the story starts here. Large enough palatine tonsils can expand posteriorly and block the Staken tube. This is an image of the opening of the Staken tube in the nasopharynx, and microbes, when they go in, they end up in the middle ear. The Staken tube is partly about one third made of bone, and the rest going medially to open into the nasopharynx is made by cartilage. This is a lateral skull x-ray where we can see the shadow of tissue in the nasopharynx posterior to the nose in the this skull x-ray, and the adenoid is in the midline. If it gets infected and gets large, it blocks one or two Staken tubes. These are two drawings showing that first the normal middle ear is usually filled with air because it is connected to the nasopharynx, and the tympanic membrane and everything works normal. In otitis media, it is filled with fluid because of blockage of the Staken tube. The fluid comes from the lining epithelium because it is a respiratory type of epithelium with goblet cells. How do we know there is a collection of fluid in the middle ear? If we compare these two sides of petrous part of the temporal bone, where there is the middle ear. Here we can see that the external auditory meatus and the middle ear is filled with air, while on the right side of the patient there is a shadow of collection of fluid. This is a closer look at the petrous part of the temporal bone. The yellow arrow is pointing at the tympanic membrane, and this area is the middle ear, which is filled with something, mostly fluid. It should be filled with air. This is a CT scan of the skull, showing the petrous part of the temporal bone. The yellow arrow is indicating the Stachian tube, the bony part, and then the green arrow is indicating the cartilaginous part opening into the nasopharynx. The lateral wall of the middle ear is the tympanic membrane. And this is not normal tympanic membrane, because there is loss of the cone of light, and tympanic membrane is not very transparent, and it is invaded by blood vessels. This is a view of the tympanic membrane through the external auditory meatus, showing dilated blood vessels, loss of cone of light, and bulging tympanic membrane. This image is showing that the middle ear is behind the eye. Therefore, usually the patient, when the process of inflammation starts, complains of pain posterior to the ear. Where is the middle ear? It's in the petrous part of the temporal bone. The shape is like biconcave lens, and it is filled with air. It's an extension of the nasopharynx. This is a view of petrous part of the temporal bone. And here are the borders of the middle ear. The middle ear has a roof, a floor, an anterior wall, and posterior wall, plus medial wall and lateral wall. This is a view of the middle ear. If we look here, this is the anterior wall. Superiorly, there is a bony canal that has a muscle. This muscle is called tensor tympani. And at the tip of the tunnel, the tendon comes out and attaches to the malleolus. Inferior to this tunnel of tensor tympani, there is the opening of the Stachian tube, and inferiorly there is the turn of the internal carotid artery. Now, the inferior wall is made of thin bone, sometimes thin bone and fibrous tissue, and there you can see the bulb of the internal jugular vein. The posterior wall, superiorly, you can see there is an opening that opens into the mastoid process called the adytes, and then you can see the mastoid air cells of the mastoid process. Then you can see that the facial canal containing the facial nerve is passing down through its own canal in the mastoid process. And there is a cone of bone containing a cone-shaped muscle called stapedius muscle. What appears out of the cone is a tendon that attaches to the handle of the stapes. The roof of the middle ear is made of very thin bone called tegmen tympani. This bone is very thin, and in severe infections it may spread the infection into the intracranial space. The medial wall of the middle ear has several features. First of all, there is the turn of the lateral semicircular canal of the inner ear. There is the facial canal. There is the oval window attaching the foot of the stapes. And there is the round window inferiorly, and there is a bulge in the middle. This is the basal turn of the cochlea of the inner ear. The lateral wall of the middle ear is made by the tympanic membrane. This is a closer look at the lateral wall of the middle ear, the tympanic membrane with the malleus handle attached to the tympanic membrane making a depression. And this is the round window, and this is the exit of the pyramidal space where the stapedius muscle is located, and the tendon of the stapedius muscle comes out and attaches to the handle of the stapes. In the upper right diagram, you can see the stapedius muscle in its cone. This is a CT scan of the right vitreous part of the temporal bone, and here you can see the tympanic membrane. Medial to it is the middle ear, and inferior and medial is the bulb of the jugular vein, and then this is the internal carotid artery running in its canal. This is a CT scan of the skull. If you look into this part, this is the lateral part of the external auditory meatus. In front of it is the temporomandibular joint. Therefore, there is a problem in the temporomandibular joint. The patient may complain of pain in the ear. And this is the jugular bulb of the jugular vein. This is the canal of the internal carotid artery. And This is the stick and tube opening into the nasopharynx. The CT scan of the petrous part of the temporal bone, showing that this is the tunnel for tensor tympani, the superior part of the anterior wall, and this is the cone of muscle of the stapedius. This is a view of the middle ear, and the red pointer is pointing at one of the ossicles, and it is the malleus attaching its arm to the tympanic membrane, creating the ambu, and these three ossicles are joined together by synovial joints. Next in series is the incus. The most medial one is the stapes, which has a handle that fits into the oval window on the medial wall of the middle ear. The part of the stapes that fits into the oval window is called foot plate. This is a scanning electron microscope showing the three ossicles. The one with a large head is the malleus, and you can see the foot plate of the stapes on your right. On the medial wall, the facial nerve enters its canal. This canal runs in the medial wall, going down, and it sends the cordi tympani. The red arrow is pointing out the facial canal containing the facial nerve. Posteriorly, there is an opening called the adytus, leading to the mastoid air cells. The red arrow is pointing at the cordi tympani, a branch of the facial nerve going towards its target, the tongue. On the medial wall of the middle ear, there is the lateral turn of the lateral semicircular canal, superior to the facial canal, inferior to the adytus. Also on the medial wall of the middle ear, there is a bulge made by the basal turn of the cochlea of the inner ear, which is called the promontory. Attached to the malleus is the tendon of the tensor tympani that comes from the superior part of the anterior wall, a muscle in a tunnel. The lateral wall of the middle ear is the tympanic membrane. The handle of the malleus attaches to the tympanic membrane and creates a depression from the outside called the ambu. On the medial wall, a branch of the glossopharyngeal nerve, which is called the tympanic nerve, comes into the middle ear and makes a plexus on the promontory. on the medial wall of the middle ear comes the tympanic nerve, which creates a plexus on the promontory, and the plexus is going to send a branch which is called the lesser petrosal nerve. The nerve supply of the middle ear, first of all, the glossopharyngeal nerve, which is going to give a branch called tympanic nerve. The tympanic nerve is sensory and parasympathetic, and sympathetic as well. Tympanic nerve enters the middle ear, forms tympanic plexus. The tympanic plexus is going to send lesser petrosal nerve, which is going to the otic ganglia, and the otic ganglia is going to supply parasympathetic fibers to the parotid glands. Always consult your mind map and your book.